So today we are talking about
SOS Brigade.
Yeah. The second to last episode of Haruhi Suzumiya season one. Broadcast order.
It's going by so quick.
I know, no, it's so true. So this is the episode called Live Alive, for those familiar with that, and for those following along at home and who don't have the who aren't familiar with broadcast versus, you know, just look for Live Alive. That's the name of the episode. That's the one we're looking at today. And it starts with a flashback to episode zero.
Episode zero.
The Adventures of Mikuru Asahina. And now we actually see the audience, the all-male audience, interestingly enough, watching that and watching the schedule there for the show. Interesting to note, actually, there are multiple things being shown there. So they didn't completely monopolize the room. So this is the episode, famously, where we actually see a school festival.
School festivals.
Yeah.
That's an interesting subject.
It sure is. We might cover that on Culture Shock at some point.
I think it'd be a good idea.
And we see Haruhi in her bunny girl outfit. Little reference back to Daikon 4. And we have Kyon wandering the halls. So the first thing about this that I think we both noted is how how wacky this school cultural festival is.
Oh, wow.
It's pretty crazy.
It's got a lot going on.
It sure does. And I think they really push that up in the beginning, in these initial shots of it. One of the things I actually really like about this episode is how it gets across that that energy of any of this kind of an event at a school. It's special. It's an unusual day. And
ramping up to the event and the big time.
Totally.
Everybody come in.
And we get stuff
come
like
to our segment of the festival.
Yep. I love how he's walking along and we get woman who is not in a school uniform doing something, a girl handing out leaflets, and then some monster.
Just random monster. Whoa, what's going on?
All right. And then there's
look at these couple.
Yeah, possibly a cross-dressing person and definitely some guy in like a gay leather outfit. I'm not quite sure. Having fun.
Fortune-telling
house. In the fortune-telling house.
They get the I Ching on the wall there.
Yeah. So this is a common thing in these school cultural festivals. You get this, the fortune-telling booth, and they say things. And so we get Yuki.
A little less than common. Giving a very detailed description of this person's future. But it's not what's going to happen in their fortunes so much as what's actually going to happen to them. Okay, you're going to you're going to trip on this. You're going to stumble, and then you're going to
give him an ice cream cone.
Yeah, it's like mundane future.
Completely mundane.
But accurate. So
good old Yuki. And then we cut to Koizumi here.
Our Esper.
Yes, our Esper, who is doing a performance of Rosencrantz and Guildenstern Are Dead. Which is
What's it?
Yeah, so these are two minor characters in Hamlet that a playwright wrote an entire play about. So basically he took the characters out of that and do a whole story about basically them in the interstitial moments between the major scenes of Hamlet.
Wow.
And kind of what they're doing. And so there's some fun things you can do there in terms of what that's talking about in sort of a meta sense of the show, where you're seeing these characters kind of outside of being the normal characters. So just as Rosencrantz and Guildenstern Are Dead is a very meta play, you know, they're doing it in this very meta show of Haruhi Suzumiya.
To be or not.
Yes, well, exactly.
The whole.
Yeah. And Koizumi's speech here, too, does also have to do with the whole idea of reality and fantasy and so forth. We also note, I think we do get a shot of the thing. Also, by the way, note that the way he's acting here very closely mimics the way he acts in the Mikuru Asahina thing, where he's doing this similar kind of, you know, and then he goes down here.
Similar to his personality. Yeah.
Yeah, and he has that very kind of awkward thing, a little bit better because he's been practicing. But similar thing, and notice all girls.
The girls are just
slight blushes on all of them. I really like the one on the far right who's kind of falling over.
Fun.
And of course, Karen in the background just can't believe it. Oh, he's come on.
Ring toss.
Yeah, doing a ring toss. Yeah.
And the ramen soto.
Yes. So there's some ramune there, which I think we have some sitting around here somewhere.
I've got like
Ah, nice. Yeah.
Different flavors.
So this is Ramune, for those from the unfamiliar. It's a very popular soda in Japan. There's a marble in the top there, which starts out. There we go. Yay.
All these different flavors.
Yeah. Oh, it's amazing. So it starts out stuck in the top, and you sort of push it down so you can drink it. It started basically as a way of doing it. Yeah. Very cool.
And if the marble rolls into the hole, then it stops the flow.
Yeah.
So you catch it between these little grooves here.
Yep.
And you can drink it.
Yeah.
Candy soda. Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, very much so. This is strawberry and kiwi. It's delicious. You can find it over here occasionally, very rarely in some stores.
The funny thing is, the first time I ever heard of this, I saw it on an anime, and I think it was, was it Razafon or something?
Yeah.
I didn't think it was real until I saw it. I said, it really exists.
Yeah. I first saw it in Magical Shopping Arcade, Aminobashi. Pops up there. And I was like, nah, can't possibly be. So Kyoto and his friends are wandering around. And again, I love how we see all these little almost dramas happening around them. We see a boy with a balloon in the back. Red balloon. Oh.
Oh. Foreshadowing.
Ooh, yeah. We also see, kind of interestingly, two girls in the background there wearing different school uniforms than this one.
So they have come from some other to enjoy this school festival.
So they're probably local, but and that happens often in these cultural festivals. You get folks from out of town, and we'll see kind of a bit about that later.
Yakisoba ticket.
So they're going to go check out Mikuru's classroom. And so remember, even though we've seen all these characters together, they're in different classrooms. So Kyon and Haruhi are together, and Ryoko too, I think. But Mikuru's in her own classroom, Yuki's in her own classroom. So they have their own thing they're doing. And we're going off to see them. And we get the delight that is Ryoko. And I just love Ryoko. Just full of energy. sees Kyle, know nothing. And just very, very proud of herself and how cute she looks. Which is certainly very true. And then the guys obviously are blushing. Oh, man. I also love that constant refrain that all the guys are like, man, Kyon, you get to hang out with all these cute girls all the time. Go on. And there's our first... Oh, shoot. Sorry. I think I got... Oh, sorry. I hate it when I do that. Back. So there's our first foreshadowing for something that happens later. For those of you eagle-eyed viewers, watch what happens right here.
Well, wait, was that a band coming?
Yeah, so a couple of girls from a band running past. So the guy
wasn't Kaon, was it?
No. Oh, yeah, that would be funny, actually. Be pretty cool. I do hope that at one point Kyoto Animation does something where, like, all the characters from all of the universes all show up in the one place. They did some fun things with Lucky Star. Everyone pays. Yep. I also like that Ryoko seems to like inspect the money to make sure it's legal or something. I don't know.
Crunch. Yep, that's okay. Exactly.
Man, talk about not trusting. So they go in and
they get paid and they queue up
and then wait half an hour. I do love the level of detail in this little sequence. I kind of focus on this a little bit, where you get a lot of frames of animation showing the girls cooking, opening the bag. We see the girl here. They even animate her head moving a little bit. And then we see Mikuru walking over, and she sees them and recognizes them and smiles a little bit. Comes over to the guy. I love Taniguchi's reaction. Just, he is so happy. Keeps blinking. And Kyon says something interesting here, where he points out that Mikuru seems much more relaxed and much more comfortable with herself. And we forget that...
She's in outfit there.
Well, yeah. She's in a slightly fetishistic outfit. But normally she's in the club room with Haruhi and Yuki, and she's so uncomfortable all the time.
What's going to happen to me today?
Yeah. And if you were on a mission to observe somebody and that somebody was stripping you constantly, you'd be a little, little concerned.
That would be kind of...
Yeah. But, and so you get, again, all these little shots of the characters wandering around in these things, wearing their outfits. Tearing strips off of the coupons to get in, talking around. Taniguchi's still just sort of
And of course,
so happy.
They wait a long time. They get their noodles and they're mediocre. But yeah, the ambiance makes up for it.
It's cheap. I love how it's just totally from a packet noodles on a paper plate with, cheap stuff. And they have to sort of push past all the guys who are waiting there. So we continue on. So here's Taniguchi trying to pick up girls. We have weird rabbit guy walking
just
by.
Just random. He's got the sign.
Again, he's got the amazing and even more swimmer. Random. Yeah. Cute girls that Taniguchi is going to try to pick up.
Let's go hit on the chicks.
We both laughed at this where he said, that's my system. And Kion says, well, when your system has a failure rate or has a success rate of zero.
Zero. Yeah, that system might need some adjustment.
Mm-hmm. One other thing you see here also, too, is all the signs taped up everywhere. Just how many people are advertising
that thing.
It's
interesting seeing the school hallway from the outside perspective looking in.
Yeah.
Through all the windows. Mm-hmm. You can really get a sort of a different feel because usually you see down the hall, the doors for the classroom are on the right and the windows are on the left or vice versa.
Yeah.
But this we see from the outside and everybody's got their stuff taped up everywhere.
Exactly. In fact, here's another sort of flash forward to what's going to happen a little later on. The live.
The band poster.
A little band poster there for that concert.
I see the guitar on there.
Yeah.
And then there's a cat.
A dance. A cat.
All sorts of crazy stuff.
Yeah. So, so we see various characters doing ring toss, being very excited, some kind of competition game.
Quiz show.
Yeah, quiz show. And again, I really liked it. I particularly love the girl just sleeping here.
all the preparation work. And of course, it's a group effort and some people pull their weight and some people pull everybody's weight.
I wonder, there's something draped over her desk. So I wonder what that is on her desk. It looks like I can't even
I'm
tell.
I'm the ticket taker for this room that's probably failed utterly.
Probably. Wake me up. So we could probably tell that if we did a bit more research, find out what that the reference to. So Kion decides to check out the music club.
Yeah, that's a place where he can relax a little bit, get some Z's. And
so they're playing a song here, a classical piece. A lot of these high schools will have a
environment.
Yeah. Just kind of relax. No one's gonna really be doing much. There's that earnest, the music director.
Yeah.
We all know that guy from high school. We see it's getting a little darker. We see two local folk guys.
Their bit.
Mm-hmm. And we see in one of the... Oh, and I should mention what's going on here. For those curious. We have and again, remember,
exciting.
He pulled the all-nighter for the videos while he's so tired.
That's right. He was up editing
episode
00's.
So this is a Japanese game where, as I recall, these are... balloons filled with water and you have chopsticks and you're trying to pick up the balloons with chopsticks, and if you can pick it up then you get a prize basically.
Oh wow.
And you just have a little basin of water and you try to pick up these little things. So it's a common festival little game. Wonderful.
He's sleeping through it. He's obviously very tired.
I also love, again, we've all known that three high school students who have to have the punk band. And so Kion wakes up and we notice that the room is filling up.
Rock club.
As a rock club called Enos is going to perform. And then we get this wonderful reaction shot from Kion very slowly. Shocking. And then
the buddy outfit.
Haruhi walks on with Yuki.
The witch outfit.
It's wonderful and crazy. And what the heck's going on? So we get our little commercial break, and it's raining now, which means more people are coming in.
Yeah, everybody's got to get out of the rain. So not only is she there, but now the place is getting packed with people.
And this, I think, also gets to Kyun's reaction here, where he's like,
"She's never done this."
Yeah, well, that's the thing. Like this is very different for Haruhi, and also there seems to be there's almost a little fear in Kyun's face here because he realizes she's setting herself up for failure. Like, it's going to go really badly for her.
How's she going to sound?
Right.
Does she even know how to... Well, maybe.
Yeah. Has she finally gone over the
edge? This is a different band.
Yeah, well, that's the weird thing. It's obviously too normal.
It's not like she's been practicing with them. She's been out hunting weird, strange stuff.
As is her wont. And we see people in the audience kind of questioning what's going on. The outfit,
but the outfit is that, just incredible.
Everybody
else is kind of.
I should also note that, you know, a few episodes ago, we know that they got in trouble for wearing these bunny girl outfits, but somehow Haruhi's managed to convince them.
It's a performance,
right? And so we cut into this. Now, anime has a history of musical sequences of animating.
That was pretty neat.
Music. Yes.
She was getting every note on the fingers there. That wasn't just sort of a blur of.
It's very rare for anime to actually try to match music to a song, to try to animate to the song. And they're clearly trying to do that here. They're lip sync to the music. The audience is starting to get it, starting to pump. And we've got this interesting sort of punk rock song, slightly punkish rock song. And Haruhi's really singing it. The bass player is doing her thing. I'll tell you, all of the AMV makers who like inserting clips of people like playing musical instruments just cheered at this moment. Because finally we get
something put in there. That guitar work is
incredible. Oh, it's great.
Yeah.
What's also interesting here is note the camera work. You see this stuff. Watch here when we cut over to Haruhi, how the camera's moving around a little bit. Like it's trying to capture her on camera.
Like a real handheld on stage guy.
Absolutely. Even though, of course, there's no man on stage.
Sean's just stunned. Everybody's bouncing to the awesome music. He's in shock.
Yeah, exactly. And again, what's interesting here is that Haruhi is putting everything into this.
She's pretty good.
She is good.
She's not just, and that's another reason to be shocked. She's actually decent.
Yeah. And she's singing a song with of course, you know, again, another sort of layer. There are these lines in English where it goes through blah, 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 blah. God knows is what goes over and over. And knowing who Haruhi might be has a neat little moment. So again, all of the animation of
vocals,
this.
Yeah, vocals,
she's yelling.
That was just incredible. That was incredible. The emotion.
Yeah. Yeah.
The performance.
Absolutely.
The intensity.
And some of that came from...
which contrasts with her...
Yeah.
With
Yuki?
With Yuki.
Yeah.
Absolutely. She's just doing her thing.
Yep. And so Haruhi's voice actress just really pelted it out here in Japanese and English. They really tried to do. Also, note the
sweat drip.
The sweat dripping drip. Down. I mean, my gosh.
Ah, giving really it all across. Away on stage.
Totally. And here's Yuki. And notice Yuki's sort of pulling, you know, she's leaning into it a little bit. She's got a little bit of energy into it. And so we continue with the song, and they finish up, and the audience is just going nuts.
I bet those typing skills came
in probably.
All the guitar work. They really loved it.
They really
what
did.
What was that one girl in the background?
Oh, yes. We wanted to point that. Let's find that. When they first start singing it, it's one of those things where you don't necessarily notice the first time. But when she decides to start, and of course, everyone's wondering what's gonna happen. And we go to this wonderful reaction shot of the audience.
And the explanation is okay. The other girls in the band couldn't make it.
This little shocked girl in
this
the back.
This little girl in the back. She's like, oh!
Little pinprick eyes, huge mouth. It's wonderful.
I mean, other people are in awe, but she's shocked.
She's completely shocked. Love it.
But yeah, the explanation is the other two band members couldn't make it. What was it? A laryngitis or
yeah, laryngitis, and one of them like broke her sprained her. Yep.
So we just picked this up.
Yeah, exactly.
Sheet music.
Sheet music. Just off the sheet music.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean that's pretty impressive. They only had an hour to practice.
Surprise.
Yeah. And so Haruhi.
For the band, here's drummer.
Well, again, here's the interesting thing. Haruhi, what's Haruhi doing?
She's sharing the glory, acknowledging other people.
Holy
smokes, amazing!
I do love it.
Oh, and everybody does their solo.
Everyone does a little solo. And she said, "And Yuki."
And Yuki just says,
no reaction.
No reaction. Nothing. Not even a strum. Yeah, she doesn't have the same stage.
No
presence.
Certainly not.
Very
certainly
technical.
Not. Yeah, absolutely.
But the stage presence Haruhi has is
absolutely.
It's impressive, and her character lends to that. She has that over the top sort of everything approach, and that's perfect for stage.
Yeah, And Liquidus, you're absolutely right in the chat room. Seeing the budget raised for this scene, it's a classic thing in anime, is that you save the budget for the important moments. Mm. This is a very important scene for Haruhi and for the development of kind of the story as a whole. Because you can't afford to, you know, lip sync all the characters all the time. Oh, that wonderful stuff from that. Haruhi seems to really be enjoying herself. Drummer, and also again, you got a note
in the drums.
I was just,
you know, you put that out. Drums, you always, you know, get all these dings in it.
Yeah, you get this wonderful sort of scar effect on the drums. It really make you feel like they're real.
Yeah,
Haruhi's enjoying herself.
he's tapping his
finger a little bit. he's acknowledged it, and everyone's hanging around in the rain as we get the rest of that next song. And then now we get the backstory of all these characters. And here's where we realize we've been seeing bits and pieces of this throughout the episode.
The band's been walking through here.
Yeah. We've watched this in the background. And so Haruhi just saw this happening and decided to volunteer. And of course, she volunteered Yuki.
Wow.
Team Finan, who picked it up immediately.
Yeah.
Amazingly enough.
Who knows she helped to play the guitar? When did she learn that? Probably as soon as you
said it. Yeah. So then they get a visit from the other girls. Now, it should be pointed out here that the other girls are upperclassmen. They're seniors. So having seen, and remember, they're freshmen. So having seniors come to freshmen to talk to them is a little scary.
Wow.
It's a fairly big deal. And you notice that Haruhi doesn't immediately just jump up.
No.
She's a little embarrassed and a little hesitant, if you might say.
That's an interesting
yeah.
emotion for her.
Totally. She does grab Kyon by the necktie and drags him over. So they come over to thank them, and Haruhi's very polite, again, kind of surprisingly.
Our mini disc sales have gone up.
Yeah. People love it. And Haruhi has this interesting reaction. She smiles a little bit. The girls are very happy with
thank
her.
Thank you.
Yeah. It's a classic kind of anime reaction. They're all enjoying it. Yeah. Hmm. But Haruhi is surprisingly subdued throughout the entire exchange.
It's like she's just taking it all in.
And there's even this moment where you see Kyung looking at her, and she's not even really smiling very much. She's kind of taking it in.
Yeah.
But it's just, you know, it's almost like she can't quite process it.
She doesn't know how to respond almost.
Totally.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. And a little bit more confidence there.
Yeah.
she suggests that they go thank Yuki. We went there. She said one word and sent us over here. Like, okay. That's pretty much Yuki. So then we see that Haruhi's kind of quiet. I love kind of the reveal of this, that Kyon says that Haruhi left immediately when lunch was announced. We see Kyon wolfing down his lunch. He's eating it, walks right out, and then he says, I decided I'd go walking to settle my stomach. And yes, that's the only reason. And we know, no, you wouldn't be wolfing your lunch and walking out immediately.
You want a settled stomach, you don't wolf your lunch.
So he walks out, and of course, he finds Haruhi.
Under a tree.
Under a tree.
In the shade.
Relaxing. Anyway, I love the sort of two aspects of this. One, the very peaceful way this goes, but also that contrast to the craziness of the school festival. This is their chance to compress. So it's interesting, kind of what they talk about here.
What did they talk about here?
Haruhi is, she's kind of worked up inside. She doesn't quite know how she should feel right now.
Yeah, she doesn't usually get thanked by other people.
Mm-hmm. And that's the thing. And something that Kyon points out, you know, the reason that you're so emotionally sort of charged is you're not used to being thanked.
And she wants him to spit out what he's thinking.
Yeah.
But if we heard his inner dialogue, mm-hmm. it would change a lot of her reactions to everything.
And it's, I actually really liked how this was translated in the fan sub, which is a little more direct, but it kind of gets across that some folks might miss. The way they translated what he says is, this is probably the first time you've ever done something for somebody else. And that's probably not accurate, yeah, but it's interesting.
Closer to his feelings about how she behaves to others. Yeah. Usually it's, okay, you're going to put on this outfit. Okay, computer club, give me your computer.
Yeah, exactly.
Otherwise, I'll...
So,
it is a generous thing of her.
Absolutely. It's the first time she's actually done something for somebody else. And it's interesting here, too, again, getting back to her little Kyon theory, that she gets really pissed off at him for not sort of talking to her. And she decides she wants to mess with him.
She tries to throw grass at this is and so cute.
Blows right back in her face.
Grabs
literally.
The clump and throws it. Her own efforts to...
and let's not, you know, forget... This is probably the first time something hasn't gone right for Haruhi.
Yeah.
You know, the world hasn't formed around her for that, which is kind of interesting that she's trying to get inside Kyon's head. And that's the one time when it's not allowed. And so, of course, she goes
very close moment for the two.
It is.
It seems like, but then her ideas of next year, we're going to form a band. That was so great. We're going to practice. Yeah, we're going to get some instruments. Yeah. We'll do some choreography and some scoring and some.
And I love how, and again, this gets back to the how they animate this. Note how like she's practicing like this tambourine. Notice how even like her pinky's up a little bit. You know, she's really, yeah, you know. Yeah, it's great. And so, of course, Kyon gets dragged off by Haruhi, and we get the pan up. What's funny here, too, is we got the joke in the first episode about every scene ends with the camera panning up, you know?
And, oh, that's, and, right,
and
back
right back to it. So, fun episode of Haruhi.
Very fun.
And then next to last episode of season one.
No!
I know.
It's ending too quick.
Very sad. What's interesting about it, though, to that point, is this feels like a final episode.
Yeah.
It feels like they've really gone somewhere with Haruhi. Kyon is feeling a little closer to Haruhi. So where are they going to go with the final episode?
Yeah.
It's a mystery.
Where could it go?
Where could it go? Well, we'll find out very
next soon. Episode. Stay tuned.
Exactly. So now let's move on to Boogiepop Phantom. So we start off with... Yeah. Episode 9, You'll Never Be Young Twice. Which says a lot.
I can try.
Well, we all kind of want to be.
Yeah.
And as is usual for Boogiepop Phantom, that is a very intentional title.
Yeah, all their titles are so intentional in contrast to some anime. I kind of wonder how the heck did they come up with this title? What's it got to do with anything?
Yeah.
But I always forget about it halfway through the story.
That's true.
Okay. But these are actually relevant further into the story, and they kind of make sense.
Yeah, absolutely. So this is an episode, and this is kind of a tough episode because it's kind of three episodes in one. We get three different characters' stories all in one episode. So lots goes on here. But we start with a hospital scene and a character with some drugs in front over this hospital bed, and a doctor coming in. We recognize the doctor. It's the creepy doctor.
The creepy doctor.
But she doesn't act, she's not acting creepy.
She's acting somewhat normal, right, at least at this.
Yeah. And she walks in and she sees this thing on the floor.
The guy with the injection for that woman has apparently gone the window.
Yeah. And
she finds the injection.
Yeah. And now we find out that the girl in the hospital bed,
Nagi.
It's Nagi.
She looks the same age as.
Yeah. So this is clearly Nagi from 5 years ago.
Yeah.
And so then we get a memory butterfly and Lisa Monaka.
But a doctor asked about that, and
she
says nothing.
Yes.
There's a weird drugs on the floor.
Right.
There's an open window. She says nothing.
And of course, we know later on she's
more a creepy doctor.
She's given drugs to people.
Yeah.
So you wonder where she might have gotten those drugs from.
Yeah.
So we've seen Monaka and Poom Poom before. Monaka, the girl with no memories, but these little butterflies. Monaka. And Poom Poom, this little boy. And then we see Nagi going. And Poom Poom says something very interesting. He's talking about Nagi, and he says her potential was taken away.
That was very strange.
Yeah.
Her potential was taken away. It's after seeing this previous scene. It's kind of like they're looking at it.
Exactly. Well, and it should be pointed out, and I'm glad you mentioned that, because the episode opens... Whoops. The episode opens very tellingly with a memory butterfly.
A memory butterfly.
It's the first thing we see. I'm sorry, it's not the first thing we see. We see this scene, and then we see between those two, we see a memory butterfly. Yeah, so that is what's happening there. We're seeing that moment. But, so Poom Poom's view is that Nagi is stunted in some way.
Yeah, by the injection?
Possibly. Mm-hmm. And we also, it's also interesting because we're seeing Nagi at the epicenter of all these things. She's doing all this investigation. She seems very special.
Yeah, it's almost like the injection gave her some distance from being pulled into this whole weird realm.
And I think that's exactly what's going on there, is that she is not as sensitive to other people as other people to these weird things happening. And so now we start getting these backstories, or these stories, and starting with Saki. And
Saki. We can drink that. Wait, no.
Different Saki.
Saki, the piano girl.
Saki, the piano girl. And I think we'll just call her the piano girl from now on because we get so many names in here. And so we see her talking to this girl about piano. And it's to the point where the piano girl has programmed in her test performance into her phone.
That's very focused, very intense.
And it should be pointed out, and we know this because we grew up with technology at this point. With the level of smartphones here, when she says program in, she literally means she had to write the notes one by one into there, get all of the timing correct. This was not just downloading something onto her phone
and transferring it.
Yeah, no, yeah. This took a lot of work. And so the other girl says, "Wow, she's so driven."
Yeah,
and I love the use of that word. She's so driven. She's changed her cell phone. To what she's practicing for. Gets a call from her dad.
It's almost like her whole life has kind of been geared around the whole piano.
Yeah,
piano thing.
Yeah, almost.
And she's studying for her entrance exam to music school.
Yeah.
And that's a very important thing, getting into the right school. It kind of sets up your future and your career. So there's a lot of pressure from parents and society and friends to get into the right school. And it's all based on entrance exams and everything leading up to that. And so you get a lot of extra help outside of your regular school just to set you up for success in the future. And the pressure of everything riding on that is just so intense.
Absolutely. And now, of course, it's hard to say here exactly what they're referring to. They say she's trying to get into Tokyo Music University. I don't know if that's actually referring to there's a Tokyo College of Music. There's a Department of Music within Tokyo University, which is very prestigious. So, that could be kind of a generic name they made up for the show. But the implication is that it is very prestigious. And we should also point out here that high school versus college is kind of different in Japan than it is over here. So over here, college is, college is the prep for your job, right? In Japan, high school is the prep for college. So once you get into the right college, employers hire directly out of specific colleges. Mm. So if you get into the right college, you're almost guaranteed a job wherever you're trying to go. Mm. So it is that entrance exam to college which determines basically your entire future.
Yeah, it's huge.
It is absolutely huge. So she sees this guy with a red balloon. It's very weird.
That's kind of strange.
Yeah, and she hears this thing in her phone. Come with me.
Yeah, her phone freaks out, and it's that weird call.
Yeah,
it's not a normal voice. It's not somebody that she recognizes. Their staticky sound. And here we see that apparently she mentions her dad not buying cars because he wants her to do well. So there he's made some sacrifices for her.
Yeah.
And apparently he's trying to do the best he can for his daughter, getting her the piano lessons and additional stuff. And so the family has now put in all this effort, time and sacrifice into her success.
Yeah.
Which may or may not have been, she may or may not want even piano so much as to please her parents at this point.
Well, and that's the thing is that, and it's really interesting actually, hearing what how the dad talks about it. Because I think the show does a very great job of his dialogue, where he's asking her about it. He's very open about it, but he's not pressuring her.
No, he's not pressuring her. He wants her success, but he's not saying you have to.
He's just, you know, so how did it go? The money's not a problem, but just how did it go? All this kind of stuff. He seems like he's really trying
to... A good nurturing encouragement.
Exactly. But of course, being, you know, 15 years old or so, she's starting to interpret that a little differently. Yeah. You know, there's a lot of pressure. And also, to be fair, you know, she is wisely, or at least intelligently, trying to interpret those signals. Mm. She knows how much they've given up.
Yeah.
And she knows they're not trying to get across it, but it's still there. And we see the music
Despite
teacher.
Despite that encouragement, the music teacher has such disdain.
Yeah.
and the
friends. I love how her friend is just very, very supportive, really. Yes. Very, very nurturing of her, of, you know, the music teacher is such a bee.
And they see the house that's overgrown. That's one that belongs to Manaka's mom and grandma.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's one where they just a few days earlier took out a dead woman.
Yep.
And grandmother.
And here we see folks leaving. We see a nurse with Manaka's mother coming out.
There's Manaka's mom.
And here's something interesting.
Do I remember you?
Yeah. And she does.
Which is kind of a rare occasion for her.
Yeah, it takes a minute, but she recognizes Saki and she remembers
the
music.
She didn't even need her pad to...
No, which is very interesting.
Music is one of those things that for Alzheimer's patients, they have more ability to recall songs than they can. And so music has a very strong foundation in memory.
Yeah. And indeed, here we see her pad.
Nope.
Now it's hard.
It down.
Now, it's hard to tell. So a couple of interesting things here. One is, of course, maybe her condition hasn't gotten too bad yet. But also, if you look at how this is drawn, we see there are a lot of pages that she's drawn on already.
Pretty far down on the
list. Yeah. So she's been doing this for a while.
The ring of memories.
Ring of memories. Yeah. And of course, memories are a very important part of this and the next episode. And so we get this interesting thing. We both noted this as we were going in, that they arrive at Saki, the piano girl's house, and the friend says, "So is this your house?"
Well, how long have they been friends?
Right. So it's odd.
Acquaintances, maybe?
Maybe.
Has she not developed a really deep, maybe?
Maybe. I'm assuming the implication there is that they've been going back and forth to music class a lot. And so maybe they just haven't, you know, gone to each other's homes before. But it's still, I mean, again, that is a hint.
Yeah.
And so now we see a little flashback. Piano. And, you know, little girl.
It reminded me of the Peanuts.
Yeah. They decided to go to a cafe. So here's an important thing. She says she doesn't want to go home.
Yeah. That's weird.
Yeah.
Well, what is the deal?
Why might that be? So we have a little conversation here, and without getting too much into it, we discover that, well, first off, we see a character burning a paper, and we might recognize this guy. He looks an awful lot like the addict from a few episodes ago.
And you reminded me, as we were watching this a few episodes back, the statement that if somebody writes the statement that had been made, if somebody writes down their memories and then burns them, that's a way of getting rid of the bad memory.
Yeah.
And again, this whole series has been cored around memories and that concept, and whether to keep them, to get rid of them, how they affect us, and all the different methods. And here they see this guy and he's burning a paper. It kind of leads to that, to erasing memories, I guess.
Yeah. And, you know, we cut back to the memory burning, and then the next thing we see is the full moment with the teacher.
Not just the excerpt. We see the, you're not good enough to go to this. I can't believe you even...
Yeah. She says, you keep this as a hobby. There's no way you're ever going to be good enough to go.
Her whole life has been based around this.
Totally.
Now,
yeah.
So you're telling her your life is over.
Too much. And of course, we all know teenagers.
You're
know,
a disappointment to your family. Your life is over. Everything you've done is nothing.
Mm-hmm. Of course, you suffered a setback. Magnified. Life is over. Oh my God.
Of course, being more mature, you can step back and say, this is one person's opinion and I don't respect it. And I'm going to go and continue regardless. And that's usually how some of the best people succeed.
Right.
Despite those kind of comments. But yeah.
And
she doesn't interpret it that way.
She sure doesn't. In fact, we see her. She's crying now
at
because
the cafe. She has small. I have small hands.
I love that.
I want big hands to play the piano better.
Yeah.
Yeah. We big hands.
You can imagine. You know, bigger hands mean you can play the piano better.
Spread three octaves.
Yeah.
That would be creepy.
True. That would be from Gattaca. So the phone goes off, and actually I really like how they animated this, where the phone goes off and then you see the eyes change a little bit in her friend, because she realizes the tone of the phone is going to remind her of the practice they just had, which they're kind of trying to forget. And so Saki starts crying. And so it says about how this is not useful anymore.
But who is calling her?
But who is calling her? It's this crackling voice again.
Join us.
Join us. Come to us.
Come with us.
And what's also interesting about this too is, speaking of hands, is the concept of growth. Mm-hmm. You know, Boogiepop Phantom, the series, is to a great extent about growth and about people maturing and changing. And how this is... You know, one of the things that Saki says is, I resent basically the way I've grown. You know, I don't have the hands I want. I haven't matured the way that I wish I had matured.
Growing into adulthood is not what I wanted.
Yeah, exactly.
this way anyway.
Right. And which leads to the next scene where she goes to Paisley Park, the amusement park. And we see these little kids around. This is horror. So we know this is not necessarily the best thing in the world. You know, kids watching you,
and who should appear but
Boom 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 Boom,
and he's got a red balloon,
and you pointed this out, which I hadn't paid attention to. That's a very bright red balloon,
in contrast to the rest of the sort of sepia tone.
Yeah,
that's the one point of very bright color in the episodes that stands out.
Yeah.
And as it's like Poom Poom just pulled the inner girl out of her with that balloon.
Yeah.
She's left standing there, but her inner child has gone off with all the kids with that red balloon.
Yeah.
Of doom.
The balloon of doom. Precisely. And then she gets this sort of creepy expression on her face.
It's like nothing bothers her as much now. Yeah. She's like, and what's scary is people who are suicidal are said to have that sort of detachment before they attempt things, and it's a really one of the urgent warning signs that somebody has a problem, when they get that complete detachment. They're not so concerned with things. But she's so, now we see later on is
she's finally gone home.
She's gone home and she's having dinner. And for somebody who plays the piano, her dexterity is going to be phenomenal. But here she's detached, she's kind of spacey, and she's thinking about this experience of her as a kid playing piano and the halcyon days of youth. And she's not really kind of engaging in dinner.
No.
And she's having trouble with her coordination.
And I mean, you know, again, you know, Americans watching this, you may have trouble with chopsticks. A 15-year-old Japanese girl is not going to have trouble with chopsticks.
Especially one who plays the piano and has good manual dexterity. And
yeah, that's a very bad sign. Her dad's kind of going, huh. And it should also be pointed out, you know, the dialogue here, again, with the father, is he's asking very gently, so how did it go? You know, did she talk? And her mother says, did they talk about price? Again, it's not a problem. And note, again, remember, she went to a cafe. She went to Paisley Park. She came home late.
Yeah.
So, you know, they're not even concerned about that. Yeah. They're very hands off. But she wants to go find her balloon. Now, and again, to a later point about the balloon, look at her right hand here. She's holding the balloon in her right hand.
As she's running along.
Yeah. But the parents don't see it.
They don't see any balloon.
No, they don't see any balloon.
in a different realm.
And here's where we go into things where, so she's going for her balloon, right? Well, what does the balloon represent?
It's sort of a break with the real world.
Yeah. So where would she find her balloon? She, you know, with the piano.
The piano.
The one connection she has to everything else. So she goes in to the room of the piano and opens it up. And there's this interesting moment where suddenly it kind of breaks. She suddenly realizes what's going on.
Oh.
And then she lets go of the balloon and just stands there in front of the piano. And then, of course, her father comes in and turns on the light.
What's she up to?
And one of the more shocking moments in the series.
This is the worst thing for a parent to see. This is horrible.
Here's what I love about this moment is that in so many stories about people who take their own lives, it focuses so much on the character. But what they show here is what it does to her family.
Mm.
You know, you can feel how her father would react to that.
Yeah.
You know, what it's doing to everyone else besides just her is just what's so horrible about it.
Yeah.
And then we move on to Akane. And we think we're just going to have another little thing
almost
with character.
Sub-story two of this
episode. but she's talking to Toka. We know. And so she's a friend with Toka, so we know this isn't going to be just a normal thing. And so we have this little thing with her, and we find out that
the guidance counselor realizes that she, even though she loves literature, mm-hmm. her scores are good in math, and therefore this girl needs to go into science.
Yeah, exactly.
There's no, here's what your passion is, here's where you're motivated, here's where you're good, you're going to go here.
Yeah, exactly.
And
practical.
As the passive younger person taking the counsel and advice of somebody who's in the position of counseling and guiding, she kind of passively accepts this deterministic approach towards her future without giving her input.
Absolutely.
Sacrificing her desires and youth for what somebody else says, this is your adult mature path.
And what's funny about that is she is telling this story to us. She actually narrates this segment to us as a story.
Oh.
She's actually, you know, writing literature, if you will, about her giving up of literature.
Yeah.
Which is so bizarre. And we see that she's writing this story called Poom Poom. Poom. That's interesting. Hmm. And now we get a little... people who talk about drama theory talk about what's called the pointer scene, where they say in every movie, action movie, you name it, there's one scene where everyone gets down and says, okay, the bad guys want X. You have to go and get X. You're going to be facing this, etc. It slows the action down. It feels forced, but you kind of have to have it in every single movie. There's just no way getting around it. And it comes back to, it was named after the scene in Raiders of the Lost Ark, when the agents come in and talk to Indiana Jones on that stage talking about the Ark. The Ark of the Covenant and Hitler wants it and all this stuff. And he gets up with a pointer and he's pointing to different things on the chalkboard. That's a pointer scene. It's almost entirely explanation about the plot, you know, just kind of to orient everyone. And this is kind of what we have in this moment in the show, where we kind of have to stop for a moment to remind everyone, okay, what does Boogiepop do? Boogiepop takes people.
Yeah.
And what has been happening? People have been disappearing. There are these
rumors. Angel of Death.
Yes. Rumors about Paisley Park, and if you go there, you claim your childhood. Yeah, and there's associations, and also this weird electrical stuff going on. So we're reminded of all these themes. Then we get this wonderful scene with
two girls walking, and they see her.
Yeah, and we see
running with a balloon.
Saki running with a balloon, and she says, "That's so weird. You know, what about the balloon?" And Toka says, "What balloon?"
Yeah. They're seeing two different things there.
She turns around and there's no balloon.
She's running with her hand holding something that's not there. Mm-hmm. Just like,
And Toka gets this very interesting expression on her face. And suddenly the way she speaks changes.
Yeah.
And there's this sort of shock and turn around. Boogiepop has just appeared. Folks, that's what just happened.
Hmm.
And then, yeah, come on. There we go. Oh, yes. And then of course, we see
burning this, the book and the floppy. Yeah. And
so Akane is burning her stories,
her memory.
And she says, I'm a senior now. I have to do, I have to prepare for my entrance exams. I don't have time for any of this anymore.
What's this phone call here?
Yeah, but then of course she gets a weird thing on the phone.
Join us.
Come with us. And so we should mention, going back to that earlier point, burning things on paper is burning memories, potentially.
She's trying to erase the memories of her story, her youth, her desire, her...
Yeah. And
her hope there.
Yeah. And unfortunately, we then see her with Poom Poom.
Poom. Boom. And what's he holding? Yeah, a red balloon.
Yeah. So that's not good.
No. Poom poom of doom.
Yes. Poom poom and a balloon of doom.
Oh my.
And then we get, oh golly. Oh,
the three Yoshiki. Guys with a girl.
Oh, Yoshiki. Poor Yoshiki.
Yeah, so this is segment three, if you're following these different episodic sub-episodes.
Yeah. And we see this interesting behavior with this young man and these guys, where they push him to go over and compliment this girl on her legs, whereupon she gives him kind of the expected reaction. She pours a drink all over him.
Meanwhile,
the guys are laughing at him.
Oh man. Did they set him up or?
Yes. I think they set him up. I mean,
they knew she was gonna, they probably already harassed her about her legs.
Well, and also I think, you know, if you're really wanting somebody to go out there and chat up a girl, you don't tell them, hey, compliment on her legs first thing.
Nice legs. That's like, yeah, you got to start somewhere more friendly.
Yeah, exactly. And so, yeah, they offer to buy a phone for him.
Hey,
and
get this one. Get this one. Well,
I'll set it up for you.
Really? Okay. Yeah. Well, okay.
And we all know how that's going to end. So, of course, you know, we're getting the hint here that this Yoshiki character is being bullied by his friends, basically.
Yeah, he's kind of his puppet there.
And he finds out that they've already played all the games. We see the column of light event, so we know
he's picking up his phone.
Yeah.
Column of light.
And we get the flash around, and then it hits him, but it also hits the phone.
Yeah. Oh, and he had a flash on him, and boom, boom, boom.
Yep.
Wow.
And then he develops his power. The poor guy, again.
He gradually starts to hear out loud internal thoughts of others.
So if you watch this with the director's commentary turned on, the English director's commentary turned on, they talk about this so wonderfully because they say, you know, everyone says how much they want when they want the power to read minds. You know,
but here's the downside of that.
Right, you know, he gains the power to read mind, but all he hears is people's negative thoughts about him. You know, and how we're only with him because it's convenient. It's terrible. You know,
we're using this guy for his resources. That's the only reason we hang out with him. Oh, it's terrible. I mean, it's like the meanest side of friendship.
It is, exactly. But also, you realize he's hanging around these guys. Like, you know.
And he voluntarily chooses to hang around these guys.
Exactly. He's a victim, but he's also letting himself be victimized to a certain extent. Granted, he's young. He doesn't quite realize what's going on. It's granted standard youthful indiscretion. But he, you know. They are his friends.
Yeah. Now, is this the encounter with the guy who notices the spider?
Yes. So here's Spider Guy.
Noticer of spiders on people.
Yeah.
And a friend.
Yeah, right.
So, to some degree.
Yeah, but yeah.
Feeling thoughts of guilt about the way he treated this guy.
So that's the thing. Yoshiki hears this guy's thoughts, who says, I'm sorry, Yoshiki, I had to give him the memory. I had to give him a memory. And so I gave him the memory of my regret about you.
Hmm.
So the friend is really protecting Yoshiki in this instance. The friend thinks the guy's after something. And so the friend offers something himself instead of Yoshiki being the target. And so in this wonderful sort of twist, he offers his regret. So what happens when you don't regret what you did to somebody?
Oh, it makes you oh, that's dangerous too.
Right. So he has, in trying to protect his friend, he's made him a much worse, he made himself a much worse person around this guy, because now he has no sympathy. Now he doesn't regret anything anymore.
Yeah. There's no conscience. Everything's fair game. And so there was.
Yep.
And justify the means.
Yeah, exactly. And it's a great kind of reminder of that danger of forgetting our memories or repressing things. You know, we have these pasts for a reason. Mm. So poor Yoshiki goes wandering around. And the one time... Oh, and then he gets this... Oh, yeah, that's right. He stumbles across Manaka. Mm. It gives him a memory of his past. Now, this is kind of unusual because we get a fragment of the past. We get this moment of him as a kid. And it's very interesting because, see here, I'm trying to remember what he says here. He looks up at himself. Somebody says, come over here.
Hmm.
And he looks up hopefully. And that's the end of the memory.
That's very short.
He's
being asked to be part of the group.
Right.
He's being asked to join, not be alone by himself.
Yeah. Well, and here's the other interesting thing, though. He wasn't alone.
He was with other kids. He was other kids.
Right. So it's this thing that, you know, he was obviously kind of putting himself in a position with these other kids. Now, also, the other kid said at one point, the other teenager said, at least you're not getting beat up all the time like you were in junior high. So they have obviously kind of protected him to a certain extent, but he has also kind of put himself in this position, and he's obviously realizing this. That's all he needed to realize. Oh wow, I made some bad life choices here.
And now I'm in a spot where Butterfly Girl.
Yeah. And so he goes out walking, and again the commentary is great about this, that the one time he actually uses his powers in a useful way, he gets something that's not damaging to him, is when he overhears these girls talking about Paisley Park and about what happens if you go to Paisley Park, which is exactly the wrong thing for him right now.
He doesn't need to go to Paisley Park. Sort of the break with reality is centered there.
Exactly.
That's Poom Poom's collection of kids location.
So he shows up and
Manaka
shows up. She starts echoing back what he says.
Yeah, he tries to have a conversation and she parrots back.
Yeah,
she like the special humans do.
Yeah, and Poom Poom says this very interesting thing. Yoshiki asks him, "Who are you?" And Poom Poom says, "Names don't matter here."
Yeah,
which is this implication that identity gets kind of erased.
Yeah. Oh wow.
You know, you aren't really an individual anymore. You're just a kid wandering around, which is kind of scary.
Yeah.
Poom Poom's freaky.
And Poom Poom wants him to bring more friends.
Right. And so here's the first time Poom Poom is actually kind of acting outside of himself. He's actually asking for something with this wonderful, odd image.
Oh, the reflection in the balloon.
Yeah, there's a reflection in the balloon, and it's distorted with the roundness of the balloon, which is, again, this a great metaphor for what's happened to him. He is now distorted.
Distorted perceptions.
Absolutely. And of course, now he's a kid. Now everything's happy.
Yeah, I could get some friends.
Yeah.
I could call everybody, and he becomes the transmitter
right.
of all these weird cell phone experiences. It seems
exactly. So here's what we've been hearing.
Join us.
Yes, he's who has
Come
been
be our friend
talking to everybody. Exactly. But then who should show up but Boogiepop?
Boogiepop,
and she shows up. She actually shows up, as I recall. Let me see here. I'm trying to remember how
you
this
were the
works.
Last one.
Yes,
I can save.
That's the thing. You're the last one I can save. And when we see the cell phone dropping to the ground, and then we cut to child Yoshiki, who realizes something's happened,
and he's got a red balloon.
He's got a red balloon,
and he sees Manaka and all the kids with balloons.
But Poom Poom says, "It's okay. Don't worry. You can just play with us."
Hmm.
And the kid's happy with that and goes. And
I wonder if he jumped forward. Off of that high point. Ooh, he was on.
Boy, that's pretty scary.
Yeah.
Then we go to the next episode, episode 10, Poom Poom. Poom, we get some background. And again, we get a narration. It Poom Poom.
So now this is episode 10?
Episode 10.
Of Boogiepop.
Yes.
Phantom.
And we hear that Poom Poom is this kind of adventurer who goes to these various lands.
Children's story.
But then we see him burn.
Oh.
And we remember.
Oh.
What the burning girl. Who,
memories.
Yes.
Memories being erased.
And there is Akane burning.
Oh, there's a stuff. Floppy drive.
A floppy disk. Floppy remember the floppy disk.
Hey, what was floppy disk? Was that like a typewriter?
Pretty much. I do want to point out here, too, actually, I'm actually rather impressed. You can just barely see at the bottom of this shot the metal melting out of the floppy disk.
Oh,
as it's kind of pooling down there. Which is getting ahead of your hint that that is literally destroyed. You're not going to get anything back from that.
Yeah, so that's probably all her writings.
Yes.
And her story, hard copy, her story, digital. She's vaporizing all these memories that cause her pain.
And it should also be pointed out, in this shot, we also see that it is in the middle of this sort of open field. So she has literally built a pyre for this. It's not just taking it out back and throwing it in an incinerator. It's almost a ritualistic
thing. It has significance. It's not just getting rid of it. She's not tossing it in the bin. She's burning it.
Yeah.
In a special
ceremony. It's time for her to move on with her life, so she believes. And so now we get some stuff at the prefectural hospital. And it's interesting because Poom Poom shows up.
She's watching the Madoka.
Yeah. Yeah. So we have, and actually, even more interesting, after the opening title thing, the first thing we see, which is kind of a surprise, is
the charm.
The charm from the guy who could disassemble people.
Yeah.
Or the girl.
And the girl and her brother.
Yeah.
And
so why is this here? Couple. Well, we know plot-wise why it's here, because this is from the moment when they encounter Monaka. But it's interesting, again, from this very deliberate perspective, you know, why they're reminding us of that.
Yeah.
Because if you recall, that was a case of sort of mistaken causes. One person had the power, but thought somebody else had the power. And she was, in a sense, absolving herself of the blame because she was putting it all on the person who was actually doing it without realizing that she was the one causing it. What's also happening here is a character who thinks he's doing the right thing, but is actually doing something for somebody else.
Poom Poom.
Yeah. So, and it's interesting too that we see Poom Poom, and I think this is the first time we see this happening. The first time we cut to Poom Poom, and again, it's why the show is so deliberate. See if we can see this moment there. Yeah, his eyes are closed. And he opens his eyes. That's, to me, that's a symbol of birth. This is Poom Poom,
his creation.
He's suddenly aware of what's going on, and then he sees Monaka, and goes down and starts talking to Monaka, and he knows what that is. He knows that Monaka has these memory butterflies, and he realizes that she's kind of useful, which is a little scary.
He invites her as a friend,
and it's also interesting here. Seeing how Monaka responds. Initially, she's as neutral as normal, but then she has this almost scared expression initially, which then softens. That's a hint. Monaka doesn't scare easily.
Am I not seeing this guy? Is this a hallucination?
Yeah, Monaka doesn't scare easily.
Paisley Park.
So we go to Paisley Park, and we get this lovely image where they decide to change some things, and things start lighting up at Paisley Park.
Yeah.
Now, some folks get a little confused by this thing. How could that be happening? Remember the electromagnetic disturbance? You know, that's flowing through everything here, and allowing electricity to act a little differently. And so she releases these butterflies, and we get a sky full of butterflies.
Wow.
Gorgeous.
Spreading out over the city.
Yes. But again, we notice it's both spreading out over the city, but it's also kind of directed. It's
going over into that area there.
Now the center of Tokyo, or that area of Tokyo. And we notice this interesting thing.
Oh, the change in...
Yeah. It flies like through,
distorting,
temporarily changes time.
Yeah.
And we cut back to Mother's Day, the episode Mother's Day.
Oh, that's right. With the flower. With
the flower.
Yeah.
And we see these memories. And we see the children. And we realize now, and kind of coming back to Mother's Day, we now know why that was happening specifically. Why she was having all those visions of her daughter, because these butterflies are flying all over the city and causing these changes in people's memories and causing them to remember things. And then we get a live action scene, oddly enough, of these different characters walking around and Poom Poom talking about what he's doing. And he says, "We are the things that adults have left behind."
Hmm.
And it's an interesting episode because we get a character who is literally, deliberately, just specifically telling us, "Here's what I am. Here's what I'm doing."
That's that. Wow.
And he's finding people, and sort of extracting their childhood from them. And he says, "You know what I'm doing here is I am." He's finding those elements of us that we leave behind when we grow up. The dreams that we have, the other things about us that we leave behind as we grow up, which requires going back to a childlike state.
And we see that exhibited with all the different people who've gone through this path. Yeah. They leave the troubles of their adult or impending adult lives to go back to this childhood state, but the doorway through which they do that is taking that balloon from him and entering into a realm of death.
Yes.
And Boogiepop apparently has some influence over this.
So. Indeed. Well, that's an interesting thing. I mean, Boogiepop is called the Angel of Death. So that's kind of an interesting question as to where she's involved.
Are these people, is Boogiepop getting credit for the death that he's acquiring? Because everybody says, "Oh, right. Have you seen Boogiepop?" Oh, you know, it's rumors and the
It's one of the neat things about Boogiepop Phantom is that because it is dealing with rumors, and that is it does reveal how what rumors are like and how unreliable rumors are. And as I mentioned before, Boogiepop Phantom is kind of about the teenage years, and you do hear all these weird rumors. You do hear all these weird things, and you want to believe them.
Yeah.
And you also realize that a lot of things aren't quite what you think they are.
Oh, it wasn't.
And so here we have Akane giving her child self over. This is the writer. And she's moving. What's also interesting here, though, and again, getting to kind of the deliberate thing of this show, she takes the balloon, and her childlike self appears, and she's surprised.
Hmm.
We haven't seen that from other people.
Yeah, other people completely forget about their current lives, but she's got some awareness of, hey, wait.
She sure does. And so then we see her burning these things. We see her child self as she was burning things. It was also kind of interesting there from a perspective of visuals. So we cut back to the burning of those.
The loss of youth, the grief of loss.
Exactly. And we get this interesting thing. So we get the burning, and then we see her burning, and we see she's literally left her child behind.
Yeah.
Literally behind her.
Wow.
As she's burning it. And then she runs off behind everyone else. Not with a balloon, importantly.
Yeah.
Her little girl, she hasn't completely let go.
No, she's still holding on.
Yeah. And then she has this little breakdown in class, and Toka's right next to her.
She's probably in a science class.
Probably. That's an interesting point, actually. That's a
math class, which she has no interest in this math. She's been led to do this, forced by circumstance, part hers, part just maturation, and relying on adults to determine what parts of her childhood she should leave behind. But she's not ready to leave her childhood behind, but it's being forced on her in the turmoil of that. Wow.
And so now we get this flashback to various characters. We see the guy running from the spider guy running while a balloon goes up. We see a young man causing fires with his mind. What is that called? Pyrokinesis, I think.
Dangerous.
Very dangerous, exactly. And so we see these various people with powers. And we see more of these butterflies going out, and we see them. We see Poom Poom is gathering more people, and now we get some backstory. Poom Poom acknowledges to Akane's child version of herself that Akane is who created him. She wrote the Poom Poom story.
Is it after this that, or is it before this that Poom Poom says humans are strange and they, not knowing they shed things most important?
Yes, it's somewhere in here. Yeah. And again, to that point, Poom Poom's perspective is that he is collecting these things that adults leave behind.
The good stuff.
Yes. This damn shame that people give up on all of these dreams. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, what should happen? Beautiful image of the balloons and the lights. But then we get, and this is where Boogiepop Phantom sort of slaps us across the face. Because it reminds us of the other side of that.
The friends become young as they abandon their adult, mm-hmm. but then the price is this.
Death, yeah.
And the memories, the balloons.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can never grow up.
Yeah.
And so, and again, we get this neat little scene between Akane and I think that's Toka.
And there's a denial of Saki's death, yes, being a serious impact. Mm-hmm. Usually when something like this happens, the response is grief or, mm-hmm. The different stages of this. But she seems mm-hmm. just strangely optimistic. And she sees her across the street mm-hmm. with a balloon.
Yeah.
Which is usually an indicator that there's some slip of reality mm-hmm. there that's going on.
Not good. But who should show up but Nagi Kirima?
Enter Nagi,
the fire witch,
to Paisley Park.
Exactly. And so she showed up to
crying child,
find out what's going on. Yeah, she sees this crying child, and she does the nice thing. She goes over to investigate and discovers that
he's a malevolent child. Yes. Here.
So the fire witch is attacked by fire, and these kids start showing up and start attacking her. And there's little as creepy as a creepy child.
Mm-hmm. Children of the corn.
Yeah, absolutely. And so she finds herself in a hall of mirrors. So we should, at this point, point out hall of mirrors, reflection.
Reflection.
Multiple personalities.
Oh, wow.
And just dealing with the whole thing of fantasy versus reality. It should also be pointed out here that what Nagi is seeing is herself. So in this shot, it is very centered on Nagi and sort of Nagi's issues. And we'll see that here in a moment where Poom Poom enters. We get a little thing about who Poom Poom is and what's going on there. Oh, yeah. So we cut back to Akane and Nagi. And this is significant because they're talking about all this. And so Toka is saying, have you heard about this Paisley Park? You can go there and you can kind of reclaim your childhood. You can let go of all these things. And whoa. Toka's walking behind her. And you'll notice Toka's got a bag with her.
Yeah.
A little duffel bag on.
She seems to always have that.
She sure does. How strange. You see the strap there. They're walking along and she's explaining about this. And Toka's, listening. And then we cut to the friend who then goes back and Toka's not there anymore. She's gone.
Where'd she go? Hey.
How strange. Toka, come on. And then we get back to our action sequence with Nagi, and she sees suddenly there is Poom Poom and Manaka. Hmm. And they start getting beneath Nagi's skin. I have this cell. I just keep looking at it. We get a memory butterfly.
Wow.
And
duck.
You say duck. It's an important thing. Nobody else ducks. Everyone else, when they see that, it just washes over them. Nagi knows enough to duck and pay attention. And she sees her father. And she sees her.
He's dead.
Yep. And then she sees herself in the hospital.
Hmm.
And the detective she was talking to. And we see Akane in there talking to her. So we know this is a long-term friend of hers. Hmm. And we get this wonderful shot of Nagi, very determined.
Yeah.
Because, and again, Nagi's another one of these characters that is very reality-based. She realizes she's being kind of played by Poom Poom. She's seeing this image of her father. And so what she does very wisely when she sees her own self, she breaks another mirror.
I'm not going to accept this image.
Exactly. And Poom Poom and Monaco release their balloons and disappear. So they realize we're not going to get to Nagi that easily.
Yeah.
That's just not going to work. But suddenly Paisley Park
is lit up.
All lit up with all of these strange things. And I'm going to throw out something here. Remember the Cowboy Bebop episode, Pierrot Le Fou?
Yeah.
That
reminds me of it. Every time I see Paisley Park, I always think of that episode.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. And this came out like a year after Bebop. So a year or two. So that might just be, their own little
Hey, we've got reminder. These skills for doing...
exactly.
It works in the story.
Hey. So, so Paisley Park sort of fires back up again, and they start chasing after Nagi. And who is there but Akane with her balloon? And she realizes, I wrote all this. I wrote Poom Poom.
Yeah.
This is all me. I want to be part of it.
Wow.
Literally, physically. So she starts...
She's walking...
Yeah, she walks toward the gears. Towards
the edge.
Which is pretty scary.
To fall into the gears of the machinery that runs the park. And
but Nagi,
Nagi grabs jumps her. In. She loses her balloon.
And it should also be pointed out here...
opportunity to
cross
over into that world that she wanted to join, that she has created.
Exactly. So a couple of important things here. This is a slow motion scene, but it is animated in slow motion. So note that they are drawing multiple drawings of that in slow motion, and there are multiple drawings of her as she's moving along. So that took a little bit of effort, but indeed, very importantly, as you said, she let go of the balloon. That sort of brought her back to reality. And we see her child self looking up at her.
Now, it's funny, in an earlier episode, and I can't remember where, there was one guy who was grieving because he let go of his balloon before joining the kids.
Mm-hmm.
And he was, it was almost like he was not allowed to come back and join the kids at that point, and he was upset about that. So here, the same thing is, she's lost that balloon there.
Mm-hmm. She can't go back, and she's horrified.
Yeah.
Quite clearly. But we start hearing a whistle.
The whistle.
The Boogiepop whistle.
The Boogiepop whistle.
And this rather shocking thing happens, actually, that I had completely forgotten happens. Because Boogiepop shows up and says, basically, okay, this is all over. I know what's going on. And Poom Poom kind of tries to play Boogiepop. And Boogiepop says, no, I don't have any regrets. I don't have any weird memories. You're not gonna do any of that to me. And there's this wonderful line where she says, so, what to do? Poom Poom is clearly somewhat or significantly Poom Poom has this interesting set expression on his face. He realizes this is serious, and Monaka's kind of freaking out a little bit. So one of the fire kids tries to hit Boogiepop, and we get this wonderful image. I don't think we've seen this before. We get a galaxy in her cloak, in Boogiepop's cloak.
Whole universe in there.
And Monaka falls off the ledge. down quite a ways onto the ground.
Splat.
Yeah, and all the kids gather around her. All the lights go off. And all the kids are gathered around her in this almost religious way. They're almost lined up around her body, which is rather interesting. And Poom Poom walks up.
And they're looking at her.
Well,
wait.
Oh.
She's old.
She's older than her own mother, strangely enough.
Her real body is very old. Mm-hmm.
And we know she's 5.
Yeah.
It's pretty freaky. And as usual, Boogiepop kind of lays down the law.
Yeah. Boogiepop was...
Yep.
Says no.
And she's...
you're...
And so Poom Poom rightly asks, why are you doing this? And Boogiepop says, because she is an enemy of this world. Which surprised me when I heard this. Monaka is an enemy of the world?
Wow, she seems so...
innocent.
Innocent and not really... Yeah.
Yeah. But she made Poom Poom. And Boogiepop says this thing.
She made Poom Poom more of the reality. Not actually the story, but she brought him to that being state.
Yes, exactly. She again, accidentally, unintentionally created Poom Poom, who then has this activity in the world. But Boogiepop says this thing: you were left behind, but you are regret.
Yeah.
You are those things that people regret leaving behind. What's important about that, and getting back to kind of this mature thing of maturity, one of the ideas here is that, yes, you do leave things behind. Yes, you do regret them, but you gotta leave things behind.
But in another sense, he's collecting people who have killed themselves, and the life that they've left, there's no going back, and the regrets of having left that in itself to return to an earlier state, even though they regret losing their childhood. Now they have a regret where they can't have the opportunity to return.
It's really a very Buddhist and also kind of a Hindu concept that, you know, basically what Poom Poom is doing is he's trying to divorce people from their regret, from their memories. And Boogiepop is saying you can't do that.
There's a reason no regret exists.
Yeah, you have to process your regret. You have to live with that and move past it, and become a whole person with that. If you just regret, and from a Buddhist perspective, if you kind of ignore it, you're gonna have to process it in the next life anyway. Yeah. You know, it's gonna stick around.
So Poom Poom gives him false hope.
Yes,
because he is he leads him to death as and.
Exactly.
And so Boogiepop's Boogiepop does not mince anything. She just lays it down.
And it's interesting too, the visuals here. There's this almost cathedral like feel to the visuals. The light filtering down from the sky. And the music, I think this is the first time, the only time they use this song in the entire series. And it is this slightly spooky, but very big instrumental song. And it really drives home the impact of this moment as you're realizing somebody who unintentionally is screwing everything up and is you're coming to that realization. And then the big question, what do you do? I mean, how do you deal with that? She also said this interesting thing, losing and regret.
Yeah,
are different.
Very different. And that's a very, very important point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can lose things. You don't have to regret them. You can regret things. You know, it's just that is the way of things. And as he realizes this, the children behind him begin to disappear and fade away.
He's now becoming aware of his own being and his role in all of this. Mm-hmm. And
which is funny because, again, you know, one of the defining elements of childhood is not accepting responsibility. You know, you just live your life and enjoy your life and all that kind of stuff. And that's how Poom Poom...
Consequence has.
Yeah, exactly. And that's how that Poom Poom's been behaving. And now he's realizing, oh,
wait.
Yeah, there are consequences to my actions. And so Boogiepop... So we get this...
His idea of denying the past to justify the present has been... a core theme, the denial of life.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I can't read my writing, but I had some note there that.
Yeah. And we cut forward to this moment where Akane is kind of coming to herself and she writes down Poom Poom.
We're back on Akane's writing it.
Yeah.
That was wow.
And it's interesting too here to me how, Toka has this almost kind of childlike reaction to this. And what's interesting is this, like, Toka wants to see, and Akane doesn't want to show it to her. And Toka says, but what are friends for? And it's a really lovely concept that, you know, you shouldn't be ashamed of these things. This literary thing, it's something you can share with people. It doesn't have to define you.
Yeah.
But it can be something that is part of your life still, but she's still very embarrassed about it, which is just kind of, you know, very interesting. Toka wants to know, and it's interesting, you know, so again, spoiler alert, Toka is Boogiepop. And so it's funny how Toka, unconsciously, she sees Poom Poom. Oh, what is that? So that's interesting. What's Poom Poom? You know, funny.
Yeah.
And we have a butterfly memory there. And Monaka.
Oh, back to Monaka.
Yeah. And she says this thing, you are death.
She recognizes Boogiepop.
Yes, you are death come to kill me. So What's notable about that?
That kind of confirms the rumors.
What else is notable about that?
Well, she's come to sort of a point of clarity.
This is the first time Minaka hasn't echoed.
Yeah, she's come to senses,
yeah,
so to speak.
Yeah.
Rather than echoing back and the whole concept of echoes and mirrors and it's all smoke.
And mirrors. Yeah, so that was quite the episode. A lot going on there.
Wow. Intense.
Very intense. Yes. So anything else we wanted to talk about in terms of Boogiepop Phantom?
Wow.
Yeah, no kidding. We have two more episodes to go. So we'll be accelerating into the end game of the story here pretty soon. And it'll be very interesting to see where the story goes there.
We have a whole bunch of comments here. Yeah. Let's see.
So the song is Angel in the Dark by MYKN. Thank you very much. Talfane, appreciate that. Let's see.
How far back was that?
To answer your question, Mr. Battlestar, I have seen these shows before. Actually, so has Evan. The way we've done this is I watched the show a long time ago. Evan watched it a little more recently. And then we rewatched it just before coming out and doing the show. So we've each watched it twice before doing these shows.
But this one, I think I could watch several times and get deeper each time because there's so much going on. I mean, I'm scribbling down notes as I'm going along, and it's, you know, there's a lot of different angles you can approach it from. So it's interesting to hear different insights and perspectives, and not having read the manga, I understand puts you at a disadvantage to some degree. As that really fills in some of the gaps.
Yeah. So I should, that's a good point to bring up. So Boogiepop is based on a series of light novels. And there are a bunch of these light novels out there. Some of them have been translated into English officially. And there's also a manga, which is not part of the story. Several of those novels were then sort of readapted into this TV series. So this is several plot lines from various novels, all reworked for this TV series by the original author. So it should be pointed out, it isn't just, you know, folks coming in there and cherry picking. The author said, here's how we're going to structure this, which is rather nice. Kohei Kodono, the original author, is kind of famous for that. He is involved in all the adaptations of his work and all of that stuff.